Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome to episode 157 of the Speared Sunnies podcast. I'm finally fucking home. Finally here. I know I missed a few episodes, but I was just like, you know what? I'm either going to have to do three Whisper podcasts in a row in that shithole place I was staying in New York, or I'll just wait till I get back and do a good one in the studio. So I'm here. Sorry that I missed a couple, but I was incredibly busy in America, and I didn't really think that perhaps maybe a fucking Airbnb with six other people in it is probably not the best podcast studio. So sorry about that. Next time I go, I'm gonna fucking hire a space and do the podcast probably. But anyway, that's a problem for future Lewis, and I'm not him at the moment, so whatever. Dude, I had the best time. So I was in New York for 2 weeks and I was in LA for 2 weeks, and it was fucking so good. I had such a good time. I got to perform. This is like some lifetime milestone shit. I got to perform at the New York Comedy Club. Shout out to my bro Andrew Schultz for organizing that. I hung out with Andrew Schultz. He's a stand-up comedian in New York. I think he's one of the fucking best comics working right now. So it's very, very cool to be hanging out with him and call him a friend. Very, very cool stuff. And he organized a spot for me at the New York Comedy Club. I got to perform. I fucking smashed too. I was so worried that they wouldn't be able to understand me, because I'm telling you, dude, you wouldn't believe it, but people serving me had so much trouble understanding my accent. America is like the center of the world. Or that's how they view themselves, right? They don't give a fuck about anyone outside it, right? They actually can't understand accents that aren't American. I had someone, we were trying to order, right, drinks. And my mate, he's Australian, he's trying to order drinks. And she couldn't understand him. And I literally, he's trying to order a Corona. So he's going, yeah, can I get a Corona? Doesn't even have a heavy accent, right? Just a normal Australian voice. He's going, yeah, can I get a Corona? And she's like, a what? A Corona. I'm sorry? A Corona. Excuse, a Corona! And she couldn't understand him. I literally had to say Corona in an American accent. I was like, he would like a Corona. And she goes, oh, a Corona. And really, Corona or Corona is not that different. That's how I said it. Corona. And then she understood. How is that any different from Corona? Corona? Corona. One sounds like you have a finger in your ass. Corona. Like, that's how you say Corona during a prostate exam. But for some reason, she couldn't understand the Australian accent. And I had that so many times trying to order food and shit. But whatever, I did my set, I smashed, I did really, really well. I was like, I'm just going to play it safe, I'm just going to do material that I know works, because it's my first set in New York at a very prestigious club. I don't want to fuck it, I'm just going to do stuff that is guaranteed to smash. That's what I told myself before I got on stage, and then I got on stage and I just started making shit up. I was like, hey, let's roll a fucking dice, very important gig in my life, whatever. So I just did like fucking like 5 minutes on how rude New Yorkers are, because they're so rude, but they're not in a mean way. There's like a difference, yeah, like there's a difference between being rude in a mean way just because you're a cunt and being rude because you just have shit to do and it's more efficient for everyone if we all just agree to cut out manners and not get angry when we don't receive politeness. That's how New Yorkers do it, and I'm totally behind it, right? Fuck please and thank you, get the fuck out of my way, I'm going to Whole Foods. But it went really well, which was fucking awesome. I think I got on stage, I did my set, and then I destroyed, and then I ran out of the club. I ran out of the club. I was like, fuck yeah, because I couldn't be celebrating while someone else was on stage because there were a few comics. But I ran out of the club. I was like, fuck yeah. And then all the way home, I was like, I'm fucking the best comedian in the fuck. I was hyping myself up. It was awesome. I fit in with all the fucking meth zombies they have there. Do you think you've seen crazy people? No, you haven't. Not till you go there. Because our crazy people at least have Centrelink. You know what I mean? They're crazy people. They go, like someone in Australia goes, I'm crazy. And then the government goes, would you like free money? And he goes, I guess I'll be sane to fill out this form. Yep, and there's my home address, and then he submits it, and then he's sane on the phone because he wants his free money, and then he's sane in the Centrelink interview, and then he gets out and he goes, I'm crazy, but I'm sane enough to pick up my Centrelink payments. In America, if you're crazy, you go, I'm crazy, and then everyone else goes, get the fuck out of the way and live in a bin. And then he's just like, oh, I guess I'm going to deteriorate and become fully insane permanently forever. That's what happens to their crazies. We went to Skid Row, man, in LA. I've never seen anything like it. It was actually a tent city. I've never seen anything like it. It's the biggest population of homeless people. So it doesn't have the most homeless people, but it's like the highest concentration. So they all live there. And it was, you go down one street and it's literally, I would say we went down one street and there's about six streets all the same as this. We went down one street for about 500 meters. It's tents, all packed in next to each other, full of homeless people. It's crazy. I've never seen anything like it. Someone ran at the car. It was terrifying. It was like if you walked down that street, you wouldn't come back. It was the fucking Walking Dead with meth and tents. Crazy shit. But what else are they going to do? You know what I mean? You can't really make fun of those people when that, like, if you're homeless in America, what do you do? Get a job. Oh, I smell like shit. I guess I'm fucked forever because I can't take a shower. It made me thankful in a lot of ways for Australia, but let's also be real. It is a better place. It's so much more fun. If you have money, it is a good place. If you don't, it's the worst place on earth. Never seen that, like, different levels of wealth either. Like, we go to Skid Row, right? Homeless tent city, actually looks like a refugee camp. No shit, literally looks like a refugee camp for blocks. And then 20-minute drive away, Rodeo Drive, all of the high-end stores, Gucci, Louis Vuitton, all that. Everyone walking around with $50,000 watches on. People decked down in diamonds and luxury clothing, rolling down the street in Rolls Royces. I think I saw about 8 Rolls Royces, and that's 20 minutes away from the most poverty I've ever seen in my life. It's crazy the amount of disparity they have there, because it's like the land of capitalism and money, but it's also the land of, we'll never be anything even remotely close to socialist. Because we kind of shot ourselves in the foot with that whole Cold War propaganda shit. We accidentally installed a culture in our own country that hates helping each other. Fuck. And it was just to win some stupid war that wasn't actually happening. Shit. But I know it was so good, and I made so many useful connections and brilliant friends. I finally got to hang out with I'm Alex and Atozi. I met Atozi for the first time. I've been talking to him for a little bit. He's a great guy, but I've known Alex for fucking years, since before his channel was smaller than mine. And now look at the little cunt. He's got like 1.5 million subscribers. I'm very proud of him. He's killing it. So it was very good to see and finally meet those boys. I've got videos coming with them very soon. It was awesome. But the people that I met in New York. So I hung out with Andrew Schultz and he showed me around, and I got to do the run, man. I didn't do it, but I got to sit with him, watch him do the run. So he did 4 comedy clubs in one night. That's so cool. Like in Melbourne, we have one club. New York, they literally have 20. So you can do 4 clubs in one night. Every night, if you want. That's crazy. Like, that's... Oh, hello, Jazz. I'm doing my podcast.
Yeah, I can hear you. Hey.
Do you want to be part of it? Oh, I don't have a mic. I'm going to have to pause it.
Yeah, pause.
All right. Be back in a second. Sorry, she's gone. She's not coming on. So what I was saying, I got to see the run happen, so that was cool. You know, jump up on stage, get off stage, get in a cab, go to another club, get on stage, get off stage, get in a cab, go back to the first club you're at because they do 2 shows a night, get on stage, get off stage, jump in a cab, go to a third club. 4 sets in one night. That's why people in America are so fucking good, because they get like, I mean, really, for me, that's almost a month. It's all 15-minute spots too. So that's like a month's worth of stage time in a one night. Like, that's fucking crazy. So that was really, really cool to see and experience. So it was very, very inspiring. Who else did I meet? I think that was it for who I met in New York. I met Dave Attell in New York. I met Dave Attell, which is great. He's a legend. I met Bert Kreischer for the second time. Didn't remember me from the first time. Wouldn't have expected him to. Who else? I think that's it. And then I went to LA, and Andrew Schultz introduced me to Andrew Santino in LA, and he took me backstage at the Comedy Store, which is just the most famous comedy club in the world. And that was fucking amazing, like seeing all of the pictures of all these young comedians, like Jerry Seinfeld when he was young as fuck, Bill Burr, just like every single comedian, Louis C.K., like Amy Schumer, Sarah Silverman, all of these fucking huge names, just when they were really young and starting out, and now they're fucking like multi-millionaires selling out all these theaters and shit. So it was very, very cool to see like all those people when they started. So Andrew Santino is a great guy. We had lunch and then he took me backstage at the Comedy Store that night, I believe. And who did I meet there? I met Neil Brennan, all these other fucking comedians. I got to go to the secret comics bar that only comedians can go to. I got to see in that one club, the Comedy Store, they have four rooms running at the same time. So they got a tiny little one that's maybe like 70 or 80 seats. Then they have the original room, I think it's called, which is maybe like 150 to 200. Then they have the main stage, which is 500. And then they have another one, I think, which I can't remember what it was called. But they either have three or four rooms operating at the same time. So you can literally do, three different stages without leaving to three different audiences too, which is fucking so cool. I think they only have three. Not four. I think I'm wrong with four. They've only got three. But very, very fucking cool shit. And then Andrew was doing Joe Rogan's show. So he was like, oh, do you want to come backstage? And I was like, fucking yeah, I do. So he takes me backstage. And next thing you know, I'm fucking hanging out with Joe Rogan for 2 hours. Which is fucking crazy. I'm not going to talk too much because it was backstage chat. We said some fuck stuff. No, we didn't. What did we talk about? I don't know. We just had the most Joe Rogan conversation ever. He asked me, he told me that I need to do martial arts because I'm tall and I would be really good at choking out people with my legs. We talked about drinking and drugs. And when I told him I don't drink, he said, oh, you're one of those guys. Talked about medical marijuana and yeah, just a whole bunch of stuff. Talked about comedy and was, I don't know, we just hung out for like fucking about an hour or so with all of the other comedians. It wasn't just me and Joe hanging out, but it was fucking very cool, very inspiring, just like hanging out with all those people so much more successful than me and being treated as an equal. He wasn't aloof, he just treated me as another comedian backstage. It was great. I didn't get a photo because I wasn't going to be that guy, because I'd bet he gets that all the time. But can I get a photo? Can I do the Joe Rogan experience? I didn't do any of that. I was like, just be cool. Just fucking enjoy the moment. Talk to the guy. And it's a cool story to tell one day. And then maybe, just maybe, when he hits you up and goes, oh, I'd love you to do my podcast one day, you'll be like, we've met before. He'll be like, oh, you're that cunt. Have you started fighting yet? You'd be really good at choking people out with your legs. So, man, it was so cool and inspiring. Like, when I booked the trip to go to America, I never in a million years would I think I'd be backstage with the biggest comedian in the world, just talking as comedians do. And the most exciting thing, I got to see Bill Burr live, finally. We were just there at the Comedy Store. He wasn't on the bill. He was a special guest. a surprise, and we're watching the show, and then out of nowhere, they're like, all right, next up, we got Bill Burr. I almost cried. I lost my shit. And I got to see him working on new gear, because I think it was like a Tuesday or a Wednesday night. It was a weeknight, and he was just working on new material. And even though I could tell that it was new, and he said it was new, and it was definitely not done, some of the funniest fucking material I've ever seen. He was talking about abortion. I'm not going to ruin it. But the first thing he does, he gets on stage, he's like, all right, let's talk about abortion. And everyone's like, oh, and he gets them all scared, and then he just reels them in with just fucking, I don't know, it was like watching an absolute master. It was very, very cool. And I think I learned a lot from seeing him and being backstage and just being around, like the fucking skill and success that you just don't see in Australia, which was, it was very inspiring. Oh, my fucking light's off. I got to turn it on. I should pause it, but I won't. All right. So that was very, very cool. America was amazing. And then, well, that's the stand-up comedian side of things. And then fucking the YouTuber side of things in LA, I had the weirdest group of people hanging out, right? So it was I'm Alex from England. It was A Tozy from Norway. Then it was Brock Baker and Chris Raygun. Brock Baker from LA, Chris Raygun from New York, and then Gabby Hanna as well from Vine. And just all of us hanging out talking. It was the weirdest collection of people, like some cunt from Australia, a Norwegian, an Englishman, someone from New York, and then LA, a voice actor from LA, and then fucking Gabby Hanna. I don't know where she's from, but she's like such a mainstream, massive, huge YouTuber who came from Vine. It was a very interesting collective of people. Gabby's lovely. I got along well with her. But it was just a fun, man, the place that fucking A Tozy booked it, right? By the way, I did a video with him. It's on his channel, and there'll be one coming for my channel with him as well. Go check it out. His one is up now, and his videos are great. I would recommend looking at them. he picked the fucking shittest place to stay, man. He picked, like, he's such a fucking, like, he's that cunt who, like, walks around with an off-white belt and, like, Gucci shoes. He had a Gucci necklace on. You know, he was a hype beast. He was one of those guys, yeah? He totally booked the Airbnb because it looked cool in the pictures, and he didn't actually think about what it would be like to stay in there, right? So it's me, Alex, and A Tozy, and his girlfriend, Hannah, lovely girl. And he basically booked my warehouse with 8 beds in it and 16 mannequins for some reason. Everywhere you fucking looked, there were mannequins that were painted with like black paint. And then there were like LED pink and blue lights everywhere. It was like the most fucking hipster Illuminati sex party den you have ever seen. It's a studio with like one raised level that had, no joke, 8 beds in the same level, no privacy. And then downstairs there were 2 bedrooms, both of them, no solid doors, all glass. So for 2 weeks, not a single wank was had by any of the boys or Hannah. And it, like, it's the kind of place where like a fucking billionaire would hire 16 Instagram whores to come over and have this creepy as fuck, eyes wide shut orgy. And he would go upstairs and he would be wearing a suit, and he would never partake, right? He wouldn't have sex. He would just sit up the top of the balcony in his nice armchair surrounded by 8 fucking mannequins watching all of these Instagram whores have sex. And he wouldn't partake at all. That's the type of place that we were at. It was fucking so, and there were no windows, right? No, 0 windows, because we were in the middle of a building. It definitely was not supposed to be where fucking people lived, right? No windows. So I went to sleep at 4 a.m. and then I woke up at 3 p.m. I fucked my own body clock because my body was like, oh, there's no sun, there's no moon. I don't know what time it is. I guess I'll have a guess. Next thing I know, I'm asleep at 4 a.m. And same thing with all the other boys. We all reverted back to like our natural time zone within that little space because there were no fucking windows to tell us what time it was. And no clocks. It was ridiculous. But I had a lot of fun with them. I got to tell you, the rumors are true. LA sucks. I couldn't live there. As much fun, as inspiring as it was with all those successful people around, it sucks. It's a giant parking lot with houses. Like, the amount of driving you have to do to get to anything is insane, and the traffic is horrendous. That's why, and every fucking fifth car was a Tesla, because they drive themselves, because no one wants to drive in LA because it's awful. It's just sitting in traffic. That's your life if you live there. Like New York, you leave your house and you're just in it. And I reckon no matter what you were looking for, whether you were looking for toilet paper, action figures, food, or a route, I reckon if you just walked in one direction without looking at maps, you would find it on that one street from just walking straight. No matter what you were looking for, you would find it. You'd be like, oh, I really need a gobby and some ice. You'd find it there. From you'd be like, oh, the gobby shop and then the ice store. You would find it. LA, like New York, I could picture when I wake up, I go down the street, I get a coffee from here, and then maybe I'll get some food from there, and then maybe I'll sit here and do some writing, and then after that, maybe I'll walk over here and go to Central Park, or maybe I'll go and do a comedy set, and like I could picture what I would do with my time, whether it was a work day or an off day. LA, I don't know what I, like I would wake up in the morning, and then there's nothing in walking distance. So I guess I'll have breakfast at home, and then I'll make my own coffee, and then I guess I'll ride at home, and then I'll also eat at home because it's a half hour drive to any kind of food, and then I'll stay in my home, and then I'll do a comedy set, and then I'll go home, and then I'll shoot myself in the brain because my whole life is at home because I don't want to drive anywhere because traffic sucks. I feel like that's your life when you live in LA. Also, there's no gym anywhere, so I'm fat. I don't know. So, the trip for me was really like, oh, okay, I think I want to end up in America, but I don't know if I like it. I need to go and check it out. And I totally confirmed, couldn't live in LA, would absolutely fucking love to live in New York. So I think that's, in my head, that's my goal. And then I think that I can get, the LA benefit is like the YouTube scene is much bigger there than it is in New York. But I feel like I'm not going to be doing collabs every fucking day, so I could just go to LA every couple of months, do some collabs, network with people, and then come back to New York. Like I met in New York, I met like an industry woman, like a behind the scenes. She'd done work for HBO and all these giant comedy networks, and she was like quite high up, and I met her for the first time. And I told her, I was like, she's like, oh, why are you here? I'm like, well, I'm doing really well in Australia, but I understand to properly make it, you got to be in America. And I'm a stand-up comedian. I'm trying to work out whether I want to live in LA or New York. That's essentially why I'm here. And she said, you should do New York, because if you're in New York and you're trying to be a stand-up comedian, everyone knows that you're there for stand-up comedy. And I was like, what do you mean? And she goes, well, look, if you're in New York, stand-up is the only thing there. So people know that if you're living there and you're doing it, they know you're fucking serious about it. Whereas in LA, all they know is that you're there to become famous, because you could end up in TV, radio, movies, plays, stand-up, whatever the fuck. Like, if you're in LA, whatever you're currently doing at the moment is just a pathway to become famous in anything. I was like, oh, that's a good point. Whereas if you're in New York, people know you're serious about becoming a good stand-up comedian. I'm like, that makes sense. And I did meet a lot of comedians in LA who were doing it in the meantime until they could take off as a model or take off as an Instagram influencer or take off as a YouTuber or whatever the fuck. They were just doing it to get skills to transfer to acting. But every comic I met in New York was like, I want to be a comedian or I will die. So I was like, ah, that makes sense. So yeah, man, it was a good experience, but I'm happy to be home because fuck, it was expensive, bro. Also, I fucking in New York, I actually stayed in a place where I was staying was such a shithole. It had bed bugs, actual real bed bugs. I was fucking covered in bites. I still have them on my arm. I was covered in bites all over. You can't see them now. But like, it was infested with bed bugs, bro. For 2 weeks, I was sleeping in a bed that had bed bugs. And I was like, oh, that's right, I'll just wash the sheets. No washing machine, no spare sheets, no nothing. So I'm like, oh, okay, I guess I'll just get eaten alive. And that's what I did. Sitting in a fuck, because it takes, because here's the thing with bed bugs. You wake up and you go, oh, I've got a mosquito bite on my arm. That's weird. Pretty cold for to have mosquitoes out. I didn't know there were many mosquitoes in when it's cold in New York. That's weird. Day two, couple more bites. Oh, I guess I'll just close the window when I sleep. I guess they're coming in through the window when I'm asleep. Day three, few more bites. Oh, fuck, this doesn't make sense. Maybe it's not mosquitoes. Day four, entire body, from your arms to your chest to your ass to your dick, covered in bites. I go, huh, I don't remember taking my dick out in Central Park and attracting mosquitoes to it. I guess I have bed bugs. By then, I was halfway through my fucking stay. Just the itchiest man alive. I looked even itchier than some of the meth zombies walking around on the street. It was absolutely fucked. And I applied for my money back. And you know what they told me? Oh, you should have complained sooner. Can't give you your money back. Oh, cool, Airbnb. No worries. I'll just get fucking eaten by bugs. And you can keep my $2,000. Good on ya. Fuck. A lot cheaper than a hotel, but still, definitely not worth it. It's the fucking worst, man. I wonder what else happened in LA. I'm going to have a look at me bloody... I think you would have noticed that I've been working on a very, very big project while I was in LA, especially. That's going to be coming out pretty soon, but I had... I can't say too much about it because it's a big secret, but... I will just let you know that there was a 3-person team from producers to camera people to behind the scenes people and people funding it of me shooting every single day for 2 weeks in LA. I don't know what we were making. I couldn't tell you that, but I could assume from watching my Snapchats that it would be something fucking huge and serious. But no, really, I've made something that I've wanted to make for a long time, and I'm incredibly proud of. So it's really good. What else happened? That's kind of it, man. Oh, I also saw Ricky Velez. He was amazing. Very, very good comedian. All right, I think that's about everything that happened on my New York trip. Oh yeah, sorry, in LA I went to Venice Beach. Don't go, it's horrible, it's awful. It's just fucking homeless cunts. Okay, here's the difference. In Skid Row, homeless people that will stab you and take your money. And you, if you walk down there, you're insane. And if you go and live there, you'll never get out. Okay, that's Skid Row. Homeless people on Venice Beach are those same people, but they do acid all the time. And they have dreadlocks. That's it. They'll just go, cool, man, and then they'll stab you. Cowbunga, dude, and then knife you in the back, take your wallet. World peace, bruh. Hit you with a club. I literally had one guy, I was walking down the street, and one guy, he gives me like the fucking, the rock, the devil horns hand sign, and then he starts headbang, and he goes, yeah, anarchy, bro, bring back anarchy. And I was like, bro, you're living in it. Okay, that your life is fucking anarchy. You've done it. Congratulations, man. And you know what you got out of living in anarchy? Your shirt smells like your ass. And you have no money. And now you're headbanging at Australians you've never met. Congratulations. There's your anarchy. What a great idea. We should apply this to the rest of society. Hey, let's get rid of laws so that a guy with a t-shirt who smells like his own rim can walk around going, yeah, anarchy, bro. I'm fucking living it up. Are ya? Or are you homeless on a beach? I can't tell. You let me know. Actually, no, I just looked. You're homeless on a beach. That's what your anarchy got you, man. Fucking hell. And their weed stores in LA are like crazy. They're like Apple stores. Like you go in and they give you weed and like I didn't go in, but I saw from the outside one of them. They give you like individually wrapped things and they got staff wearing the same t-shirt. It's so funny. And then to go back to Australia and see how weed dealers here do it, where it's like just some guy with like a massive dog and a singlet. And he's just giving you weed that is not good. And he's like, that'll be $100, thanks. call the cops and I'll kill you. And then you go to LA and it's people dressed up as scientists growing weed that has different names like Curly Whirly and the Snoop Dogg and the Wizzle Woo-Woo. And everyone has their own fucking favorite strain. Oh, man. But yeah, it's good to be home. I've booked a bunch of gigs. Doing the Comics Lounge soon. It's very, very good. Gee, for a guy who took a fucking 3 weeks off his own podcast, he doesn't have much to say, does he? All right, should we do some emails here? I think we should. If you would like to send an email to the podcast, you have a life advice question that you need answered or anything like that, send it to podcast@lewspears.com, summarize it in the subject line, and I'll get back to you. No, I don't want to look at all inboxes. There we go. Okay. Oh, here we go. We got an email from Vasilios, the world's loosest podcast contributor. If you don't know the stories of Vasilios, you should go back and listen to a few old episodes because he's a loose cunt. Breaking into my... You know what's funny? I've met Vasilios a lot of times and you would... Listening to his stories that he sends in, you'd be like, that's bullshit. No way that happened. No one would do it. I've met him. All right, he's not a friend of mine. He comes to my shows. I'm not trashing him. I'm saying that he's not like a friend who's fucking around and I'm covering for him. I'm saying that this guy is a real human being who comes to my shows. He doesn't live in Melbourne. And every time I meet him, I'm like, oh, yeah, you would do that. All right. Hey, Lewis. This one's called Breaking Into My Old High School. Good on you, Vasilios. Hey, Lewis. It's Vasilios again. I was just talking with an old mate and remembered the time we broke... See, and this is how you know it's true as well, is he goes, oh, yeah, I remember this. Like, it's not, oh, I've got the most fucked story. He's just like, oh, I forgot about this one. This one's like a 7 for me. I've done some heinous stuff that I can't write down, but this one's pretty good too. Hey, Lewis, it's Vasilios again. I was talking with an old mate and remembered the time we broke into our high school in the holidays after we graduated year 10 and weren't going there anymore because in Canberra high schools only go from 7 to 10 and then 11 to 12 is a separate school called college. Okay, that's weird. So one night, me and a few mates got drunk as somewhere in a park or something, and then we came up with the great idea to break into our old school. So we go down, jump the fence up to one of the doors, and they're the typical school doors with a metal squat on the bottom and the square window above. Oh, metal square on the bottom and square window above. We booted the bottom square in with a kick, started running through the school, fucking up computers by throwing chairs at them in the library and breaking into teachers' staff rooms and fucking with their shit. Fuck, that's so Canberra. Fucking with the shit. And later on, after smoking weed in the school, dude, you stayed there? Are you fucking stupid? Oh, let's commit crimes and then just hang out there. That's a good idea. You do it and then you run, idiot. Later on, after smoking weed in the school, we ended up setting all the fire hoses off through the school. And this was the week of Christmas, so no cunt was going in there for a while. What are you doing? I love reckless vandalism. Cut to the next year when my brother goes back. Turns out we ruined the carpet and the floorboards for the entire school. They needed to replace them all 3 weeks before school came back and had to replace most of the computers, and a lot of the computers we didn't break were fucked from water damage. I can't remember how much it cost, but it was a fuckload, lol. Anyway, have a shit one. Your cooked cunt Vasilios. And he spelled your as you are. Because of course he did. Thanks, Vasilios, you fucking criminal. You need to be locked up soon. Every story you send in gets worse and worse. Please don't stop. I would love to read more. Fuck, man. That's insane. Okay, this is another good one. Girlfriend wants an open relationship. Dump her! Hey, Lewis. I'm a big fan of the podcast and your channel. I love it. Keep it up. Thank you. Anyway... Last week, my girlfriend dropped this bombshell on me that she doesn't really believe in monogamy. I don't really believe in monogamy. I don't really, but why do people who cunts say that. I just don't believe it. I just feel like I believe, and for me and I and my feelings, disregard, I don't believe, just say, hey, I want to suck other dicks. I want to fuck a bunch of other people. You don't have to go, I don't believe in monogamy because it exists. Why don't you just say, I don't want to be monogamous? Why do you say, I just don't, like, you're making it sound like it's some kind of higher moral being and you're elevating humanity. No, you're not. You're not elevating anything apart from other people's penises. Just say, I want to fuck other people. You don't have to be monogamous, but you don't get to say, I just feel like monogamy is bullshit and me sucking on other people all the time is a better thing for everyone. No. Because other people exist. Better thing for you. I just don't believe in I just don't believe that you're doing anything other than being a dickhead. Just say, hey, I want to fucking suck heaps of cunts. That's what you should say. I just feel like I want to fucking suck other cunts. You don't have to say, I don't believe in monogamy like you're some kind of enlightened yogi. Anyway. I don't know this bitch. She could be a lovely girl. She doesn't really believe in monogamy and that she would like us to be in an open relationship next year. We've been dating for about a year and a half. By next year, she means our senior year of high school. So she's not being polyamorous. She's being horny because she's 18. And she wants the best of both worlds. Because you can't be polyamorous in high school. What is she going to do? Fuck all of your friends? What? There's only fucking a couple hundred people in your year? And you're going to have sit in math class with the guy that she's been sitting on? I don't think so. She doesn't want to have an open relationship. She's just horny, but she also wants emotional support from you. Now, call me crazy, because I know this is a lot of guys' dreams. I think you might want to reconsider, bro. That's not a lot of guys' dreams. A lot of guys' dreams is like maybe a threesome once. I don't go to sleep and then wake up thinking, oh man, that dream where my girlfriend cheated on me heaps was awesome. But I think when you're with someone, you're with them and shouldn't be sleeping around, even if both parties are cool with it. That's where you're wrong. If both parties are cool with it, that's fine. That's totally fine. But you're obviously not, so it's not fine. Should I give it a try or tell her I'm not cool with it? Thanks, man. Have a shit one. Yeah, look, you should definitely not do it because clearly you're not cool with it. You just said it yourself. I believe that it shouldn't happen even if both people are okay with it. So you're not even okay with other people doing it. How would you feel if it was your relationship? You need to say, hey, babe, I understand that you feel that way, but that's not for me. So if you would like to do that, you can do that while you're single. Don't be like a cunt about it, but just say, you can do that, but it won't be with me. So you either need to choose to be with me or be with all the dicks you can fit in your mouth. It's totally up to you. Yeah, you can't. Obviously, you're not cool with that. Don't do it because that shit, I'm not even convinced that shit works even when both people are okay with it. I think that shit's doomed to fail. There might be people out there that could prove me wrong, but I haven't fucking seen it. And I also haven't seen it for like a 10-year relationship. Do you know what I mean? I don't think that shit works. And especially not if you're not okay with it, bro. So yeah, fuck that. Guys, that brings us to the end of the podcast. I thought I would do a shit one. A Freudian slip. I thought I would do one that sucks just to come back to go, fuck you. I thought I would do a short one just to bring back and get you guys all into the swing of it again. I'm going to be back every single Sunday. And videos are rolling. I believe I put out a video a couple of days ago. Should be really good. So I'm very happy. Content's going to start rolling again. The podcast is back. Everything's happening. I'm gearing up for the tour. That'll be happening at the end of the year. I almost have my hour already, and I am fucking psyched. I got a bunch of new material out of America. I think that's why I don't have many American stories, because they're all going in the show. I'm saving them, especially the fucked ones. So thank you very much for listening, guys. I will talk to you guys next Sunday, and make sure you share the podcast around if you enjoyed it. It helps me grow, and support me on Patreon if you want to get early access to everything. Oh, a new episode of Me and Mike came out as well. If you would like the Patreon exclusive podcast, it's fucking there for however much money you want to spend a month. Even if it's a dollar, you get it. So, thanks, guys. I will talk to you next Sunday. I hope you have a fucking shit one. See ya.